started. And I first want to do so by saying I'm very glad you all are here. This project that I'm undertaking is one that I have very little expertise for most of the things I'm trying to mobilize. But many of the people in the room do have that expertise, so I'm hoping to tap that. I want to also open by expressing a great deal of gratitude to Jaime Mata Figueres, who is the reason why I ended up doing a cool project instead of doing a very boring pedestrian project. Not only did he guide me to the Celtic music bars in A Coruña, his home, but he also said, hey, you know, if you're going to be working over there, this is really cool ritual you should check out. So thank you very much. I appreciate that. And is Melissa Biggs here? It's that she's somebody who I also owe a debt of gratitude to. The horses you hear are on a narrow mountain road in Galicia, and we've been herding them all afternoon, and now we're trying to move this procession along. We've stopped at this point because a group of the horses have bolted away. So we're trying to maintain the 200 odd horses in this one long column in some kind of stasis while they're pushing the boundaries, trying to escape. This is an image of the initial roundup, and I'll go into a lot of detail about this ritual and why I think it's interesting and the larger stakes I have in all of this in reorienting social theory around the species term. But let me give the kind of ethnographic frame here. And I started out to study these horses. These are two different breeds that are the focus of a group called Rewilding Europe. And the objective is to return horses to abandoned landscapes. So there in Santander, it's around a port, been a previous industrial zone. And they're encouraged to eat back some of the invasive plant species. And then out in Extremadura, obviously a much more arid zone, this breed of horses, along with a breed of cattle, they're imagining how to breed them back to kind of prehistoric stock through a process of directed breeding and by turning them loose in this zone. So that's what I started out to do, rewilding Europe. Jaime says, why don't you check out this rapa das bestas? It's basically shaving of the beasts. Shaving of the beasts. And it takes place in this ring of coral. It's like a rodeo ring at the start. It's kind of an ethnic event, they have the dance and the music, and then they bring in the horses, and madness ensues. And it's a lot more interesting on a kind of day-to-day basis than studying the sociality of these other horses, but I will get back to them. One more bit of ethnographic context, a nod to Severin Foles' excellent talk a couple of weeks ago. This is a part of Spain that's just dense with petroglyphs. And you probably can't see these. It's hard to see them in the rock itself, but I took a picture. It's a series of mounted riders. The horses were depicted. And this is early Bronze Age, probably involved in hunting reindeer. And if you take into account the caves of Altamira, for instance, you have about a 20,000 year scope of our species paying very rapt, observant attention to their species. This is, I bring it up because there's obviously some really interesting ideas or rethinking of domestication happening here. with the idea that you can undo it by rewilding. But then also here, the bestas, they're called wild, called feral. Most of them are owned, but they spent the entire year running free up on these mountaintops. So are they feral or not? But there's a great tension over the line of domestication within these sites, and then more broadly, thinking about the petroglyphs and such. Okay, what am I up to here? And basically, about the time I undertook this project in Spain in 2010 was just when multi-species ethnography came into focus through a piece co-written by Stefan Helmreich and Evan Kirksey in Cultural Anthropology. And that notion of frame very thoroughgoingly changed the way I was approaching field work in Mexico as well. And I shifted towards making the non-humans the focus of my ethnographic work. Multi-species ethnography poses a basic question: how do we incorporate non-humans into ethnographic accounts? Can we make them an ethnographic subject? Can we just sort of add them on as an additional layer? I've come up with a provisional answer to that question, and it's kind of simple. Well, let's analyze the sociality of non-humans. There are a great number of social species. Now, this won't cover all of them, obviously, but this will let us think through both overlaps and divergences, as well as parallels with the sociality of humans. The impediment to doing it is we have this thing called social theory, and this is what you know Marx, Weber, Durkheim, kind of predicate to most of the work that people in cultural anthropology do today, and what I teach our students here. And the problems are twofold. It's predicated, in a sense, on excluding the non-human. Marx made it very clear that when we're talking about species being, there's a shift from just existing to being able to labor. The other problem is the fixation on representation. And if you think about the series of current terms, in addition to the species term, the affective term, the new materialist term, all of them are turning in some way against the focus on representation, against text-based models, against using language as a principal frame. Now, I've been engaging in some of this kind of broader reorienting of social theory through my Aesop's Anthropology project. This came out as an ebook end of 2014, Creative Commons license, have at it, run with it. A blog in which I kind of write steadily on what's happening with research on non-human sociality. And that's the kind of stuff that I also post on my Twitter account. So one more kind of dense slide, and then I'll get into the fun stuff. I got a bunch of video footage that I'm going to run. And to make the basic point that when I'm talking about non-human sociality, horses are a great example. They are highly social creatures. What do we mean by that? They have societies comprised of bands that kind of come together and come apart, very much like the fusion dynamics in primates, humans certainly, cetaceans as well. These bands interact over the same kind of territory, leave the same range, so they're in frequent contact with others in different groups within this larger agglomeration. They're interband forms of dominance, so there are social relationships kind of scaling up and down. I'll be talking about this means of analyzing horse facial
expression. But the key idea is that social species need to be very attuned to emotion and its interpretation. Okay, so dead spot is gone. Here we are on the mountaintop. And the horses are out there. You cannot see them. I couldn't see them. They had to point them out, and they're down here in this little glade. And what happens is at the beginning of July each year in the small village, a group of people assembles, and it's almost as many kind of tourists, cameramen, as it is people from the village and those who come home for the holidays. They trek up that mountain and start a formation like this. We're ringing out over a very broad territory and then trying to surround and then corral those horses. So let's meet the horses. And the best way to do it is to show you this video. And I'm going to mute that and just kind of introduce it. This is on the second day. This is after we've herded them on the mountain, and they spent the night in large corral, and now they're being brought into town for this event. There's about 250 adults, about 100 foals. They're coming down in staggered clumps, so they don't get going all as one mass. You'll see people involved in this ritual, the people on horseback, certainly, but the larger number of people are on foot, both as they go out and gather in the horses, and as they lead them down here into town. And so, you know, this is just shy of 4 minutes. I'm going to let that run, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about the kind of conceptual work I've been doing. The work I just finished up, Care of the Species, which is on razas de maíz, or races of corn, in Mexico, and botanical gardens in Spain. I've worked at transposing concepts. So a concept like care of the self, Michel Foucault. I could apply it to work being done on the razas de maíz, and I'll show you a slide of that in a few minutes. I've shifted forward, and like a concept like species formation, where I'm taking an earlier Marxist formulation, social formation, and transposing it in order to have it signify differently and to be able to talk about species, jarring it out from a kind of naturalistic frame, thinking about it in terms of unassemblage, but then also reorienting the initial kind of founding block of social theory more broadly. In what I'm doing now, I'm instead trying to just work with concepts that apply directly across the species line. So I'm going to use the concept of face, Bergen Goffin's concept of face. And I might do it well, I might do it poorly, you'll let me know. This is all very experimental and preliminary at this stage. I'll be going back next summer. I basically arrived, you know, the day before and tried to figure out everything that was going on. So all of the footage I'm going to show you today is kind of there's a couple of layers to it. You can see what I was initially paying attention to, and then now how I'm trying to think through it. Thinking through it in terms of transposing concepts. Another one is ritual. Ritual applies across species lines. All vertebrates have rituals. So in talking about ritual here, I'm going to pivot on Clifford Geertz's account of the cockfight and deep play. And in that analysis, kind of a penultimate assertion of the text-based model for doing cultural analysis and saying that meanings are what we are trying to get to, and it's really only real for the cost. It's not real for the humans because it's a social display and construction status. So let me segue out of here, because that's the end. A lot of horses. Okay, let's go back. And so what I'm going to give you in the next set of video clips are some scenes where I see sociality at work. And it's not necessarily how sociality has been talked about. For instance, this will be an example of boundary work. And that's something we're very clear about with a cultural analysis of humans. I haven't really seen it applied much in ethnology, I'm not sure. A kind of stabilizing dynamic that takes place in the midst of just the chaos and fury of the curl. That's a form of sociality manifesting, I'm convinced, or at least strongly suspect. And then the concept of faith. So to set up this next scene, which is again on the first day, and the first batch of horses is coming in. And it's of a band that diverged. Some of them escaped. Only about half of them were brought in. And you can see the flora here. It's a very dense thicket of fern and goza, this horrible prickly plant that rips up your skin. So the horses like to concentrate in that because the humans don't. Out of this band, this mare peels off and maintained a position on the outer fringe, and she was continually scanning the other mountains to see what was going on, and I'll show you that now. What was going on? Where did I go from here? I go down. These video clips were just way too large to put into the. Okay. Here we go. Okay, Bobby, work. I titled this. I won't put up the sound because the wind is blowing. But what you can see here is the next batch is coming in. And all of these horses are you know, she's getting excited. The big batch of them are just standing still. So we'll watch them arrive. And you tell me what you think is happening here. And I'm sure there's going to be a lot of this. I had to get out of the way. So some of them move very seamlessly in and rejoin with their previous bandmates. And then another chunk of them are going to be working to get in, and another batch doesn't want to have anything to do with them at all. They can't escape, but they aren't going in there and joining. And then mare is kind of staring them down. And I'm trying to figure out what to focus on. You know, at that time, I didn't know, really. But I, you know, my ethnographer antenna were, you know, tingling, so I figured something social was happening. Now, you can kind of see where the humans are. You can see that batch formed up very intensely, and this one over here. And I'm wondering, wow, what's going on? They start moving in.
Are the humans giving them any cues?
No, they're still standing far back because they were concerned about as broad of a perimeter at that point. They aren't going all the way in, yet they start making that move, and you can still see that that kind of group nucleus is over there. So I'm suggesting this looks like boundary work to me. They are sorting out belonging, difference, group at different scales, interpersonal, relationships, and I can't analyze that in full, but that's my intuition here. And I'll go on now to another one. And these will now take you into the Kura, where the event is unfolding. Is that going? Yes, it is. All right, so here we are. Let me just stop the action real quick. The first stage of the ritual, they're all brought in to the Kura, and the bagpipes stop playing, and he's like, shh, we're going to be running wild here. And there's an announcer. Actually, I'll turn that up, and we can ask Kanye for explanation, because it's all in good Lego. So, and it's similar enough to cut down that you have to get. What they're doing after they're all in there is taking the foals out. So all the foals and adults come in. And what you're going to see are lots of acts of aggression over here, where they're biting and kicking. And this is what people fixate on. All of the imagery about this ritual in kind of broad media and even within the town itself, where they have lots of photos of this horse aggression. It's exactly fixated on these kinds of interactions. And I'll just play this. Oh, actually, here, let me put that on. Stop the this one here. Back there, and then let's turn this back. Go. The narrator knows everybody by name, all the participants. It's a very small village, so he's talking about different members, and he's talking about the kids. But you see what's going on over here with the horses. Climbing out the back, kicking, lots of bites. Where they're concentrated, initially at least, that's what's going on. Okay, well then what happens? I have to answer them too. So here we're going to see the next stage of the event, where they start to tackle the horse in order to shear it. And they work in teams of three people. One person will get the tail, one person jumps on it. They ideally want to get it down on the ground. That's hard to do. And you'll see a couple of these sort of tackles. But keep an eye on what's happening here with the horses. So there's their an initial attempt. And that just displaces that action, that energy, and then you see the bites. And there's our mare, our mare. So through this movement of the shearing, the horses get compressed, and then they have numerous interactions, some of which are edgy, aggressive, and some of which are actually fairly tranquil, calm. You'll see them put the head on the back of another horse while that one's being bit, so there's just a huge range of facial interactions, and that's of course what I'm interested in getting into. So they're expressing both aggression and one another. the aggression are the ones most often. So he's on the horse, running into the mass, they're gonna try to get him down, they can't. But again, immobilize him enough to go with him. Sure, and then that triggers all of these other series of interactions. There again, that's the kind of act that people fixate on. That's really fascinating. And when I started, that's what I looked at. And now you'll notice here, I was like, wait a minute, what about this whole other mass of horses? What's going on with them? Why are they so calm comparatively? And I'm still following the action, so I'm not really thinking about that very clearly. But subsequent footage focuses on this, and I ask, you know, what's the social capacity for them to be so calm in this situation, such as where they are being compressed by the rodeo gesture. They are not acting out aggressively. Okay, and then I'll show two more clips. Let's go down to eye level now, so you can see. At this, I took on the third day. And I'll just say really quick, this is also the initial stage where they're taking out the foals. And you'll see a kid. It's the kids who come in to take out the foal. And you see the tapestry of facial dynamics here. It's very hard for them to separate. Now the announcer will say that they're asserting territoriality, just like they do up on the mountain. The announcer says many things. He says, we call them beasts, but the people in the world don't think of them as beasts. They think of them as spirits of the mountain. But I really don't care what the humans think. That's still a punchline. I'm trying to shut that out entirely. I learn from some of it. I pick up what people explain to me as ways of paying attention to what the horses are doing. But I'm really disinterested in the meanings, the representation that people have in this event. I want to understand the sociality of these forces and what occurs to it during this ritual, or how this ritual manifests various dimensions of horse sociality that you probably couldn't get at in kind of a natural setting, certainly in kind of, you know, untamed, semi-feral space. That's it, I think. Oh, wait. One more. And this is tiny. So, same curl from when I showed you those opening tips. And you know, what I find impressive and what I am convinced is a function or aspect of sociality is how placid they are and how much they engage additionally in these kinds of gestures. You have two heads on one horse's back, another head cushion in between. Okay, now the ride. And basically, you know, when we use social to explain is that why don't we rip each other apart? You know, why don't we kill each other? Why don't we just act out aggressively all the time if it's in our limited self-interest to do so? And there is something analogous or parallel at work here. So here they pen the horse, and that's it. Okay, good. All right, back to the dense slides. Oh, actually, here. So following this event in the Kuro, they are turned loose and they run back to town and they go up into another pen, and this is just a large hilltop where they're, you know, loose. And people from the town come up and check them out and wander around in the field. You have like a couple there, and they sat there for an hour just watching the horses. All the old guys from town who own many of the horses come up and they comment on kinship, etc. Now here's another kind of boundary work moment that I observed. This group kind of banded together. They were in the woods. They're advancing here on this trough. The mare is leading them, the stallions behind, and the foals there. And I could just watch them over the course of about 5 minutes make a similar kind of maneuver as I showed you with the bicolored mare. There's this moment of face-to-face. The stallion is waiting for that to be resolved and then advances up here to where you get at the water. So lots of little dynamics like that. Oh no, wait. Horse. Okay, I'm missing one. No. There it is. Okay. Right. As I said, initially I worked on transposing concepts, so from care of the self to care of the species. This is the process of selfing maize. You take a white paper bag and put it over the female fluorescence while the male fluorescence is still coming out. Then that gets bagged too. And you take the pollen from the male and put it onto the female, and you self that plant and you self that maize. It was very useful as a concept to think about the distinctive life forms that they were producing at Longhebio, this biodiversity genetics lab in Guanajuato, New Mexico. So here I see the mapping populations that are created through a process of trying to move some of the biodiversity of the Rosses into hybrids. I can see that there's a boundary of the species, but of just regular hybrid plants. There's an afterlife of data created for this species. And it's also very useful for thinking about the conservation efforts in the botanical gardens, the seed banks, because they're very involved in thinking about the genetic structure now of the plants that they collect and preserve in the seed banks. But now I just want to just go straight. None of this transposing. Okay, it's face. Just a couple of basic quotes. And the first one is from an article we're talking about primates principally. Basic statements. There's an awful lot of social information there. Horses in particular have a lot of. But how do you sort of work analytically beyond just the descriptive level? So that's where I turn to Goffman. This coding system, originally developed to apply to humans, gradually expanded to zebras, and it was only recently that they said, hey, why don't we try this on horses? And it's one of those kind of continual blind spots you see in botany as well, where domestic species don't get taken seriously in terms of ethological analysis. So that piece I gave you is from this, and it makes the point that our musculature is very similar. So there's kind of a material or physiological basis for saying, well, okay, how does this work on humans? How does it work on horses, given this kind of similarity? And there's, you know, two dozen different kinds of facial action units that they distinguish that I will be trying to then apply ethnographically. But Goffman, right? Concept. And, you know, you can just substitute horse for person there, but how far does that go? Now, this concept of face, it's got both an internal and external dimension. It operates on this notion of line that you establish yourself in the situation through the evaluation of the other participants. You don't intend to do this. All this is unintentional and unconscious, right? This is the condition of interaction. It's not something that the people set out to maintain. So face involves social values, playing for a self, and then importantly, how that person's presentation is read externally, the line others assume that they are taking in this particular context. So I will be trying to analyze face in these different settings. And there's, you know, is it the case that there's a lot of face work going on among those horses? Well, if you look at these interactions and you see this kind of configuration, and then as well, you know, this kind of nuzzling of noses, you say, yes, there is obviously a lot of face work going on. These are social beings, they have social structures, and they're working through that. One of the interesting things, the horse whinnies that I was playing at the beginning, they are used in greeting and farewell rituals. There's horses have biphonation, so there's two different frequencies that are operating independently, and there's going to be an intro, climax, and end to these. Are the greeting rituals occurring in the peche, in the big open corral? That's going to be something I'm going to try to figure out. And farewells is what each of these rituals, in Goffman's term, established that the relationship is what it was, or will be what it is, will we meet again. So I've just run through this face-to-face encounters. And then here's this other thing I saw that, to me, spoke of a restorative act. When somebody loses face, which arguably this whole this ritual is, in some sense, designed to humiliate the horses, whether they are or not, certainly to dominate them by the shaving. So I saw this interaction here, when the mare is nuzzling the young stallion's mane, and he's really enjoying it. And it's a very odd thing. I asked some horse people if they had seen that before, and they said no. So is it a restorative that? He's been sheared, basically. He's been already through it, and the other one has not. Okay, so again, just working straight across species lines, no transpositions, ritual, I indicated earlier. Now, I take this out of the standard cultural anthropology textbook. This is nothing radical to be asserting this. The ways you can talk about it's commonality across species lines, catalytic, transformative, in the animal world, all kinds of vocalizations. Humans, what makes us different is meaning. We put meaning on ritual. And so if I'm not interested in the humans, I'm not gonna be paying attention to that dimension of ritual. I'm gonna be looking at these other aspects. Well, how do you do that, Hartigan? Again, let's figure out. And I turned to Gertz, of course, who I've taught since graduate school in the discussion sections. Deep play notes on the Balinese cockfighting. And just a couple of images to orient you to that. It's a similar kind of ritual in that the non-human is the center of it. Geertz argues that they aren't really because there's a lot of symbolic dynamic to it. He has some interesting statement, and of course, Geertz is following very closely on Goffman's sense of ritual. He invokes Goffman and the in the cockfight. The general thesis is that it's a dramatization of sociality, of social status. They get caught up in the themes because they're being performed. It's an image, a model, a metaphor. And one of the things that I'm trying to do at this point is articulate a shift away from the idea of follow the metaphor, which has been very big in multi-sided ethnography. George Marcus talked about it. I'm trying instead to follow the species. And I will elaborate on that in the question period following this. It's not assuaging anything, it's displaying it. It's really real only to the cause, because nobody dies, nobody's castrated, as you might think, from the way they emotionally respond to this event. Now, it's interesting because his analysis opens up early on to say, well, there's a more than metaphorical thing going on. And that's where the cock craves. They love the cocks. Groom, feed, discuss them. If you've ever read The Newer by Evans Pritchard, it's analogous to how they relate to the cows instead of dreamy self-absorption. And yet, at the same time, it's this larger, oh yeah, so here, when they engage, it's not just the owner's self, but it's this othering, the status of animality, which is completely abhorrent. I'm asking, can I shift from basically a meaning-focused definition of culture or frame to a medium focus? And, you know, Geertz moves in the exact opposite direction, so he should be a good God. And when I'm in the field, I say, do the opposite of Geertz. What would Geertz do here? Okay, do the opposite. Think about the opposite. It's largely interpretive, it's the story that they're telling. And here, as I mentioned earlier, if you want to look for the key assertion of the text-based approach in cultural anthropology, which, again, the affective turn and the non-representational theory, the new materialism are all trying to avoid or do something different. It's there as well. So I think it would be, again, a useful touchstone. And just broadly then, to wrap this up so there's time for a discussion, culture as mediums of sociality rather than thinking about meaning. When I'm saying that human sociality is the center of the analytic frame, what happens with culture, I think it's possible to move it past the dualist formulation. Nature, culture. We have to get past that formulation, and that exactly, I think, opens up the mediums of sociality. In addition to face, body, the horses are just enormous resonators, and they're posturing in various ways. The vocalization that we're barely even touching, I'm a little anxious about that. Which of these will be most accessible to me analytically? That's what I'm going to find out. And I hope you all might be able to offer some thoughts on that. So let's open it up for comments and questions.
Yeah. Well, that was great.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So I have a question about other sensory ways of understanding
Because
face potentially privileges sight. And
yes.
Horses are very,
they're very visual.
They're visual, but they also are olfactory too. And smell is really important. And nuzzling.
So
that's something else. I just wanted to ask about, like, how do you account for other sensory?
I've yet to tap that. I'm starting with face because it's the most quantified kind of format where I can say, well, this is that.
Right.
And the nuzzling, because it's arguably more effective, is not there yet. Chris, you want to talk about eyes?
Yeah, I just want to say along these lines, olfaction is obviously really important to horses. You know, they're typical mammals in terms of their brains and how much of their brain is devoted to processing olfactory information. But this is actually a great time to privileged vision, if I can say that, because horses are on record as having maybe the highest visual acuity in the mammal world outside of primates. And it's actually almost a monkey-like level of visual acuity. So their ability to see details and therefore to recognize differences and gradations in facial expressions is going to be very, very high compared to a typical mammal.
Yes.
So I think it's a great question, but I wouldn't be overly concerned about, you know, in this case. In a lot of cases, you know, people think, well, I can see it, why can't the animal see it? But in the case of horses, the horses can probably see what you see.
Yes, yes, yeah. And there's the evolutionary aspect of this, too. Because like the idea of expressive face, eyes being a component of that, the thinking had been, well, if you're further removed phylogenetically from humans, you have a less complex face. Well, horses have a very complex face and a complex eye structure. Is it because we evolve similarly in response to the savanna as it expands? Is there some kind of parallel evolutionary dynamic that would undergird the notions of sameness here? But I don't know yet. Yes, Liza? And
so are you planning on coding their faces and looking at that in slow motion? And
yes, that would be the ideal, yes. To take that fax system, and they've got it broken down very well, but there's an image for each one, and there's a lot of variation in how the mouth moves, what the ears are doing, the eyes. And then, yes, you would try to record a series of interactions. Well, like go back over the ones I have now. Record those, and then try to say, okay, why pause it. What interaction I think is happening, what kind of social dynamic is occurring, and then link that back when I go back next year. It's the same horses, and they all know them. So I ought to be able to identify them and associate them with particular bands. So part of the function, they argue, of the Rapa is to break up the bands so they get greater crossbreeding among them.
So it's the same horses every year, so they that they are habituated to the rituals.
Some of them are.
Succumb,
yes, I think that is some. You know, they're long lived, so yeah. But I think the bigger difference there is, you know, the kind of initial stage, both when the foals are being removed, which is stressful, and when the kind of initial rides are taking. And then, just 20 minutes later, when you see them really calm down in the portion of the girl where they're not being shot. So, but what do you think?
I think you should look at the slow motion.
Yes. That's my next goal. Courtney?
I wanted to just actually reference a different gears. Where, you know, there's supposed to be a difference between a twitch and a wink.
Yes, yes.
So do horses have twitches and winks?
They don't wink, apparently.
Well, I think...
Blink. What do you call it? Wink? Yeah, wink. No. It comes up in the fax system, and they refuse to code it because that would imply an intentional gesture on the part of the horse. So yes, the wink is a factor. Do they actually do wink, but the coders are reticent about identifying it? Or do they not wink? Or do I not make a claim about that because it would imply intention, whereas most of sociality is unintended? So, or, you know, I mean, that's the kind of baseline I would think about it. Yes, Bustin.
Well, John, I really enjoyed your talk, and I think that's exciting that you're shifting the focus from the human interactions and the animal interactions. I think potentially it's a new discipline, like horsology or whatever you would call it. But I was just wondering, what about an inevitable anthropomorphism, if I know that?
The what?
Anthropomorphism, you know.
Ethnomorphizing.
Yeah, ethno what?
Ethnopomorphizing, what, you know, it's like...
And even in this table, it's like, you know what, there is a this correspondence with special,
sure.
special muscles and human face and horse face is like.
What if there is a physiological similarity? It's not quite anthropomorphic, right? And these are domesticates, so we've anthropomorphized them. We have bred them to be responsive to us. So you know, there's a social relationship there as well. You know, anthropomorphizing, as I understand it, is when you project human intention. If I was calling them persons, so they have rights and obligations and stuff. Instead of like having a self, which is just maintaining a state of homeostasis over against an environment, then that's different from anthropomorphizing. If it's good that they're social, and I can look at what undergirds that sociality in the face, and then be kind of buttressed in this notion that that musculature is similar, then I think the risk of anthropomorphizing is undercut, but not ever eliminated. But I don't know, what do other people think? Yes,
Tony. I just have a question going back to the bite, right? And,
yeah.
And I'm thinking of Bateson.
Yes.
And bite versus nip.
Bite. Yes.
And so,
yeah.
So do they bite? Do they nip? What's
yes, yes. They do both. They do both. Thank you. Because that's very important. You know, what signals play versus aggression? And this is one of the slides I downloaded. This is a bite, but they do nips just with the lips as well. And you can see that interaction, its initiation, and the kind of outcome from it. So they do both. And that would be interesting to compare to wings. Wings, nips. All right, I'm learning here. Nips. Yeah.
Can I add one more?
Please.
To get back to Goffin for a second.
Yeah, please.
He actually takes the ethologist notion of ritualization and applies it to humans in one of these transpositions you're talking
about. Really?
At the end of footing.
Okay.
And his example is whispering. Whispering as an acoustic signal has certain properties which keeps other people from hearing it. But sometimes we find ourselves whispering even when no one's around to indicate, hush, hush, this is a secret.
Yeah.
Which is a ritualized for Goffin. Gesture, which has something of the same property as a wink and a blink.
Right.
So
are they whispering?
Yeah. Well, are they whispering
moments?
In a ritualized way? Do they
right.
have ritualized ways of acting, which are not merely just material.
Right.
But
right.
you use the word intention. You could say that there are cultural codes.
Or cultural form. Right.
Cultural form. Indeed.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which and then we get back to Janet's point about what are they doing vocally,
yes.
norously,
because they nick
so
in certain
yes.
situations and they do it. I
feel like breathing. I'm sure
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
Codes. Yes. Sophia.
Now thinking because you mentioned it's going to be the same voices.
Yeah.
It just crossed my mind that in Greece the herds of the sheep or the cattle
mm-hmm.
or the goats,
yeah.
the shepherd knows them even if he owns 200, knows
yeah.
them directly. Like
individually. Yeah.
Individually.
Yes.
Which
yeah.
they have, of course, a collective identity and responses. This
sure.
is the response to fear. But then they
right.
have an individual character and they have names that they feed their character. And
right.
Very, very, very unique, each one of them among the
yes.
200. I'm not seeing that.
That's where I get anxious, the personality level, right?
They have very.
Yes,
but
I know it would be weird, the risk of anthropomorphizing. It's high, that's probably, but you know, other people will tell you, I mean, who work with not humans, yes, and personality is evident, right? Jeanette, do you want to jump in here?
I'm going to leave off of the anthropology and speak
okay.
about the person. So
please, thank you.
If people want to speak more about anthropology, though, I should speak there.
No, speak now, please.
Okay.
The horses have been waiting all this time for somebody.
Okay, John had a really hard time with this.
You did?
I did.
I get it wrong?
In some areas, maybe.
Okay. Yes.
The video stressed me out so much that
okay.
I just had to leave.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, it's okay. It's
yeah.
okay. I can live with it. But this amount of stress and pain and fear
mm-hmm.
is, to me, so palpable that like my face gets red. Like,
yeah.
Just thinking about it, and I get a little shaky.
Yeah.
And part of it, it's not that I have a big, you know, kind of like, oh, welfare, like that's
no.
It, but just I spend so much time with horses and teaching
sure.
people how to communicate and stress their horses out less, that to me it was like
right.
so overwhelmingly stressful.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm like, yeah, well. But in some sense, I think if you want to think about this as sociology, or sociality, which
yeah.
it absolutely is, you have to say this is sociality under extreme
sure.
stress.
Sure.
Extreme stress. And even though they're quote unquote habituated to this,
right.
they do this every year, the fact, first of all, that they're taken off of their familiar range,
sure.
driven along,
yes.
separated from their friends, then put into this pen, for horses, proximity is like, we don't want this, right? They choose the horses
right.
to be close to when they have space, but being forced into an enclosed space is completely
yeah.
like emotional shutdown.
Sure. Well, I mean, with, yes, maybe, yes. I don't know. I mean, yes, generally. But, okay, you're absolutely right. Yes, this is sociality under stress. I think sociality would be most evident, probably, in that circumstance, arguably. But there's this alteration that happens. So there's the moment of stress, and then there's the rest of the afternoon and the morning where they're on this hit hilltop to themselves.
Regroup.
Yes, exactly. Or you know, you're doing something different. I mean, they might have reorganized the bands that they came in on. It's going to be an opportunity to drift apart, whatever. So yes, but I think that alteration will be very informative.
Absolutely.
For
absolutely. And I like that kind of idea of saying, okay, so we stress them out on this thing, but then what's really interesting too is to see how it all plays out when they get back into this spacious area and can do some of this less mediated
yes.
socializing, right? I think that's super fascinating. Where I think,
good. And then the very last stage of the ritual, this after on the fourth day, they lead the horses back up the mountain
mm-hmm.
in this long procession. I didn't get to see this, I had to go. And they just start grazing, and they slowly drift away. It's not like they bolt and run. Oh, we've
right.
got to get out of here. So I want to look at that moment. Yes, Chris.
I just want to offer an analogy maybe from the primatological
yeah.
world. Even if it's not perfect, whenever you are darting a wild social group of primates,
yeah.
so you can take tissue samples or put on radio collars and things like that, you do indeed observe social behaviors as this is happening. There's typically a lot of stress involved. But they're not what you would want to necessarily analyze if you were trying to figure out how that social behavior
right.
typically plays out, because
right.
of this unusual, let's call it an anthropogenic set of circumstances.
Yes.
And then when you release the animals and they regroup, you observe something analogous, you find. You see greetings and you hear vocalizations as they try to sort themselves out in the forest versus
yeah.
a social group. So I think,
right.
I guess in a way, I think you're both right. I think you're definitely going to observe social behavior,
mm-hmm.
right, under the
right.
circumstances of being in the corral, but at the same time, it's not going to be typical. I mean,
right. and
you have to keep in mind that you're
point.
Seeing this really, really
yes.
unusual situation.
That's the fault line between ethology, as I understand it, which tries to study natural circumstances, and ethnography, which is deployed in human circumstances, or and what I realized I want to get at is not an ethnography of horses; it's an ethnography of sociality, as it manifests in the horses in this ritual. So how do I start understanding sociality differently from my perspective of social theory? And that might do something to ameliorate that kind of the starkness of that divide. But I do recognize that, and I think that's a major fault line in how human and non-human are sorted out in social sciences. Yes.
Okay, this was just in the popular science
yeah.
news, but there is an article that indicated a study was done that horses respond to human facial expressions, that they
yes.
read them and
they
respond.
Very much do, yes.
So if that's the case and
yeah.
they're responding correctly, then I would think that there's more overlap even without an anthropogenic, anthropocentric.
Yes.
I'm jet lagged.
Yes.
There's something real.
Yes.
Some real overlap. That that they're...
Yes.
And they also have done studies on cats that say when cats go into a room where they don't know what's going on, they'll look to their owners to, or the people they live with, to get clues as to how to respond.
Absolutely. There was just a study last week that was published. Horses show pictures of angry humans.
Right,
and they responded completely differently. So they're reading emotion, they're reading face.
Which indicates there's some overlap. That's
Yes. No, there would be, I would think, with material similarities of musculature, or perhaps a longer evolutionary trajectories in parallel around Puerto Rico, the grasslands. So yes, thank you. Other comments? Thoughts? Questions? Yes, please.
Yeah,
please.
So you mentioned at one point that you were curious, you expressed curiosity about the fact that within the large corrals you have groups of individuals that are fighting and individuals that act relatively calmly.
Yes.
I would imagine that maybe some of that might stem from previous relationships. So
yes.
Is there a way you're going to be able to kind of account for the fact that, you know, these horses live in these bands where they have repeated interactions with each other and establish relationships. So maybe what you're seeing is just the calm ones have been able to reshuffle themselves to be with horses that they know.
Yes, I'm definitely going to have to get that perspective. And it's not always all the same horses. They go up and gather what they can. So there might not be some overlap. But I've got to go out there before the ritual event and observe the bands, which several people do. It's kind of like a pastime. And get that as a baseline.
Yeah.
And then that's absolutely fundamental to come up with a really, really reliable account of what happens in the ritual context. So thank you. Yes.
Of course. And then one more comment. So please. You might be aware of this already, but there's a group of people that do something very... They've performed studies of wild horses in the U.S. So they have really long-term data sets.
Oh.
I apologize, I don't know the name, but I can find it for you relatively quickly.
Would you please?
There's an article, I think, in Scientific American. I have it sitting in my house.
Okay. That'd be fantastic.
There are people in the U.S. that do have data, long-term data sets about sociality.
Okay, yeah. Great, good. Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah. Anything else? Thank you. Thanks very much.